Africans south of the Sahara did not use the wheel, and in this video I want to explore why that might have been. First of all, I want to address right away a couple of guesses that some people might make. Some people might guess that Africans did not adopt the wheel because they lacked innovation or, you know, technological creativity. But we know from historical and archaeological evidence that that's not true because they had other technologies. They had textile production, they worked with iron. When Europeans arrived in Africa, the African rulers were quite eager to acquire their firearms and even produce firearms locally. So we can rule that out right now. They were perfectly fine creating and adopting technologies. Another guess that someone might make would be that, well, the people of sub-Saharan Africa were cut off from the rest of the world and therefore did not have the opportunity to borrow technologies from Europe and Asia. But we also know that that's not true because large parts of Africa were, in fact, connected with the rest of the world through trade networks. In West Africa, they were connected to the Mediterranean through the Trans-Saharan Trade Network. And in East Africa and parts of Southern Africa, they were tied into the Indian Ocean Trade Network. And in fact, some African merchants did visit India and Southeast Asia in the Middle Ages and would have had the opportunity to see wheeled carts firsthand. And yet they never used that technology in Africa. So the question remains, why didn't they have the wheel? In order to answer that question, I want to start by raising another question, which is, why would we expect Africans to use the wheel? We might assume that that was the standard mode of transporting goods in other parts of the world, but that's not actually the case. Of course, in North and South America, they never used wheeled transport prior to the arrival of the Spanish and Portuguese. But also in the Eastern Hemisphere, in Europe itself, wheeled transport was not the preferred mode of transportation. Europeans in the Middle Ages preferred to transport their goods by water, either by boat along the coastlines or on the rivers. And that suited Europe very well because Europe is a peninsula of peninsulas and has an abundance of navigable rivers. So that was always what Europeans tried to use because it was so cheap and easy to transport by water. Far easier and cheaper than transporting via a wagon or a cart over a road. You know, there were large parts of the year when the roads, which were just mud tracks, basically, were not really passable to wagons. So even in Europe itself, wheeled transport was not the preferred option. They did use it as a secondary option. It was used for local transport of goods, usually. It was very rarely used for long-distance transport, but it could be used, for example, between a farm and a neighboring village or town, or within a town, or to get from the river to that, you know, the last leg of the journey up to a settlement. Something like that could happen. But if we zoom out and look at the Eastern Hemisphere as a whole, we see that pretty much no one used wheeled transport as their preferred mode of transportation. Like I said, in Europe, they preferred water transportation whenever possible. That was also true in southern China and Southeast Asia, where there were similar conditions, lots of navigable rivers and coastline, and in the case of China, tons and tons of canals. So they did have wheels there that they used for transportation. They used wagons and carts, but those were always the secondary mode, not the primary mode. And then if you look in between those two extreme parts of Eurasia, in between in the Middle East, Central Asia, and then extending over into North Africa, North India, Northern China, the preferred mode of transportation was the camel. And in fact, it was so preferred that in many of those regions, wheeled transport did not exist at all. Now, in the ancient world, they did use wagons and carts a lot, even in the Near East. But in late antiquity, around the 4th, 5th centuries of the Common Era, they transitioned away from carts and wagons and to camels. And the reason for that was very simple. Camels were better, basically. They could carry more weight, and they could do it more cheaply. Camels were easier to procure. They were cheaper to construct. You don't construct a camel. They were cheaper to maintain, cheaper to operate. And they did not require roads to be maintained the way wheeled transport would require. So it was far and away a superior technology over wagons. And because of that, they completely displaced wagons, such that in many of the areas where camels were used, wheeled transport was virtually unknown. There were some kind of edge areas where camels and wagons coexisted, like in Anatolia, North India, places like that. But there were large areas of Eurasia and North Africa where wheeled transport had completely disappeared.
Before us stretches the desert, hundreds of miles of sand and gravel, sometimes firm and smooth so that we can make good time, sometimes perfectly hard under a thin covering of soft sand, sometimes soft and without bottom under a thin, hard crust, which suddenly gives way under the wheels. Sometimes, as we shoveled and sweated, a camel caravan would pass. And how scornfully the camels would look at us.
And so, in light of that, we might also ask another question, which is, why didn't Europe adopt the camel? And that's basically a similar question to asking why Africans did not use the wheel. There is a demonstrably superior technology that the people of Europe failed to use. Now, was it because Europeans lacked innovation? Was it because they lacked the creativity to realize the potentials of using camel transport? Or were they so mired in cultural conservatism that they could not transition to a better technology even when it was staring them in the face? Because after all, they were aware of camel technology, they were aware of camel caravans, but they didn't adopt it. I would suggest that it wasn't a problem of lack of innovation. Now, hear me out. Let's assume, for the sake of argument, that Europeans are human beings. And like all other human beings on the planet, they have innovation, they have creativity, they have the ability to adopt new technologies when those technologies present themselves and when they are useful to them. After all, that's what every other population in the world does. So there's no reason to assume that Europeans would be any different. Okay, but if we take those assumptions as given, and if we assume that Europeans had innovation, how do we account for the fact that they did not adopt the camel, since we know the camel was a superior technology? At this point, you might be thinking, well, dummy, obviously, it's because of environment. You know, camels are not well suited to the European environment. To which I say, yeah, exactly. That's it. That's the point. At least that's the consensus view among Africanists who have written on this topic regarding Africa. Why did they not use the wheel? It's because of environmental reasons. You know, in order to operate wagons, you have to have animals to pull the wagons. And in the case of much of sub-Saharan Africa, it's not possible to have those animals, or at least it wasn't historically, because of trypanosomiasis, or sleeping sickness, which is a disease that is fatal to livestock. And it's spread by an insect called the tsetse, or the tsetse fly. So anywhere where the tsetse fly lives, those are areas that historically they could not keep livestock, and therefore they would have no use for wheeled vehicles, because they would have no animals to pull them.
This deadly disease is one of the most widespread in Africa, especially in the equatorial areas. So effective have been its inroads that large areas where colonization was attempted had to be abandoned by both settlers and the natives. Sleeping sickness not only attacks man, but it attacks and kills his domestic livestock as well. Sleeping sickness is caused by a protozoan organism, the trypanosome. There are different species of trypanosome. In general, they're about 20 microns long, equipped with a flagellum and undulating membrane for locomotion.
Now, there are some parts of sub-Saharan Africa where the tsetse fly does not live, and therefore trypanosomiasis is not a problem. And there were population groups in East and Southern Africa that historically kept cattle, and some still do. And those could have had wheels, they could have used wagons pulled by livestock, but they didn't do that there either. I think the reason for that You know, wagons are useful for farmers to transport their goods to the market. But cattle herders don't really need wagons to do that. They can have their product walk to the market itself. So you have the situation where areas that were wet enough to sustain agriculture also had the tsetse fly, and therefore they could not use livestock. And those areas that were more arid, too arid for a tsetse fly, were also typically too arid for rain-fed agriculture. I would love it if there any Africanists discover this video and want to chime in and, you know, tell me about sources I may have missed or angles on this topic that I might not have covered. Please, by all means, put them in the comments. And if I said something that was incorrect or something that's out of date, it's very possible, because I'm not a specialist in Africa, so it's very possible that I missed out on some more recent literature. So if there's recent scholarship on this that challenges what I've said, please also put that in the comments so I can learn. But yeah, thanks for watching.
We'd given the little boys cigarettes and pennies, and they hated to see us go. But the town was preparing to give us a send-off in the manner of the Sahara. As we drove, the crowd around us grew. And soon the sand and gravel kicked up with the flying hoofs of the horses made me fear for our windshield. In the heavy sand, we tried vainly to overtake the furiously galloping horses.